Thousands of towns were liberated. What survivors were left came out to give thanks to their deliverer. This is Marshal Zhukov, liberator of the Ukraine. At last, the guerrilla fighters who had fought so long behind enemy lines could come back to their homes.
Simultaneously, across the world, the United States Navy had attained sufficient strength for a drive across the Central Pacific. Their path lay through the Gilbert and Marshall Islands, which through the years had been heavily fortified by the Japanese. Powerful task forces built around new aircraft carriers led the way. Guns of America's new battle fleet shelled Japanese positions in advance of the assault troops. Carrier and land-based planes poured steel and fire on the defenders. On the foot soldier that the ultimate decision rested. In the face of withering enemy fire, American Marines and Army troops made landings on Tiny Islands, Tarawa and Makin, Kwajalein and Eniwetok. Savage hand-to-hand struggles were fought for possession of a fly speck on the map, but these fly specks dominated hundreds of thousands of square miles of ocean. Thousand Imperial Japanese Marines were wiped out on Tarawa alone. This was part of the price the Americans paid for Tarawa.
While these battles were still being fought, President Roosevelt and Prime Minister Churchill met with Generalissimo Chiang Kai-shek in Cairo. Japan, these three allies agreed, shall be stripped of all the islands she has seized and all the territory stolen from China. The power of Japan's ruling class to upset the peace of the Pacific must be forever destroyed. Her ambition of a world empire must be shattered. A tremendous task still lay ahead. Tokyo was a long way off, and Japanese resistance would grow with every step of the way. To liberate the Pacific countries from Japanese occupation, was a major war in itself. But however long it takes, after the defeat of tyrant Germany, the turn of tyrant Japan will come. 5 days after the Cairo conference, another conference was held at Tehran, capital of Allied Iran. Here, the chief executives of Britain and the United States met for the first time with Marshal Stalin. They reaffirmed their country's determination to work together in the war and in the peace to follow. In a joint statement, they declared, "We shall seek the cooperation and active participation of all nations, large and small, where peoples in heart and mind are dedicated, as are our own peoples, to the elimination of tyranny and slavery, oppression and intolerance. We will welcome them, as they may choose to come, into the world family of democratic nations." These Yugoslav partisans had already made their choice. Although their country was under German occupation, they were never defeated. Under the leadership of Marshal Tito, 300,000 of them fought on unceasingly. The underground in France and the other occupied countries organized to form strong reserve armies, waiting for the day when they could join the United Nations in the fight against the common enemy. The dawn of that day came on June 6, 1944. Allied armies, troops of the United States, Great Britain, the Dominions, and forces of the men who had escaped from the occupied countries, all under the supreme command of General Eisenhower, set out by sea and air for Normandy. Germany was now being attacked simultaneously from Russia in the east, from Italy in the south, and from Great Britain in the west. This was the operation planned 6 months before at Tehran.
It was no easy task. In Europe and the Pacific, months of savage, bloody fighting lay ahead. Every foot of the way was bitterly contested by a ruthless enemy. But step by step, he was pushed back by the Allied armies. The underground forces of liberation knew their finest hour when the people of Paris rose to strike at the enemy. Even as the Allies battered at the gates, freedom returned to the city of life. Freedom. This was the prize for which millions of free men had taken up arms, for which men had been willing to sacrifice their treasure and their lives. Only free peoples would be equal to the task of healing the wounds left by tyranny and aggression. But freedom cannot be secure without final victory, whatever the price that must be paid. It is in this knowledge that the Allied armies push relentlessly on, determined that with victory will come the fulfillment of the declaration made at Tehran, that all the peoples of the world may live free lives, untouched by tyranny, and according to their varying desires and their own consciences.